A PDF of additional materials accompanies this program. Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Ambassadors, America's Diplomats on the Front Lines by Paul Richter, read by Fred Sanders. Chapter 1. The Best People for the Worst Places. On a mild day in February 2009, President Barack Obama appeared before 2,000 camouflage-clad Marines in Camp Lejeune, North Carolina, to announce plans to wind down the Iraq War. American and foreign audiences had been waiting for months to hear how the new president would deal with the six-year-old conflict, and his remarks drew worldwide attention. Almost unnoticed in the text was a line thanking a career diplomat who, as ambassador to Iraq, helped shape a successful effort to check the country's bloody insurgency. Americans owed a debt of gratitude to Ryan C. Crocker, an unsung hero who had always sought the toughest assignments and was an example of the very best our country has to offer, Obama said. Crocker and a small number of seasoned diplomats like him were central players throughout the long campaign that America waged in the greater Middle East in the decade and a half after the September 11, 2001 terrorist attacks. In the aftermath of 9/11, the country began dispatching waves of troops and civilian specialists to the Middle East and South Asia to try to overcome security threats and steady fractured societies. These ambassadors, practicing a new diplomacy of the front lines, became Washington, D.C.'s preeminent troubleshooters and primary links to foreign leaders. Presidents and secretaries of state sometimes heeded their advice and sometimes didn't. But even when they chose a different path, they continued to seek out these ambassadors to ask their guidance and recruit them for new assignments. Although their names were unknown to most at home, they became a crucial line of national defense. The American leaders these diplomats served never solved the puzzle of the greater Middle East. Two presidents of different parties blundered getting into conflicts and stumbled trying to exit or avoid them. They were overwhelmed by the dysfunction of the world's most volatile region and buffeted by the pressures of U.S. domestic politics. Now Americans yearn for an end to the forever wars in the Muslim world. Yet the nation can't retreat from the effort to stabilize weak countries. This mission, the foremost task of these diplomats, is more important than ever. Unstable lands continue to threaten not only those in the Muslim world's long arc of instability, but also in Central and South America, Sub-Saharan Africa, and other regions. Washington needs to find ways to steady these countries using diplomacy and political and economic leverage, if not American armies. Left alone, they will menace their neighbors and the distant American homeland, too, with extremist violence, mass migration, economic turmoil, and transnational crime. The threat they pose remains among the most urgent of security challenges. The story of these diplomats' experiences offers a window onto the history and lessons of America's long struggle. Dispatched repeatedly to the most important and difficult posts, these foreign service hands saw the conflicts from all angles. They met with warlords and terrorist chiefs and witnessed bloody civil strife from street corners. They heard the whispered secrets of Arab rulers and took part in White House strategy sessions. They did not have all the answers, they are the first to admit. But through their many tours, they learned at closest range what happened in embattled capitals and on the far sides of the blast walls and razor wire. They saw which of Washington's decisions brought progress and which led to disaster. After decades in the region, they returned home with an unmatched understanding of the capabilities and limits of American power. The diplomats were present as the new era of U.S. involvement began after the shock of the September 11 attacks. As years passed and Washington's interests in the region shifted, they moved from capital to capital and remained at the center of the action. The first American intervention came within a month of 9/11, when U.S., British, and Afghan forces routed the Taliban government, which had provided a haven for the Al-Qaeda terrorists who attacked the United States. Within days after the Taliban fled the capital of Kabul, a small landing party of U.S. diplomats arrived there to help set up the replacement government that had been organized by world powers. 18 months later, 177,000 U.S. and allied troops invaded Iraq to oust Saddam Hussein, whom they incorrectly believed to be developing nuclear arms that threatened the world. Saddam's fall left the country in chaos and opened years of bloody struggle among Iraq's ethnic and religious groups. The Pentagon was first put in charge of running post-war Iraq, but U.S. diplomats took an ever larger role over the next 8 years in efforts to build a functioning state. By the end of the decade, Washington's attention turned back to South Asia, where the Taliban and allied militant groups again threatened the weak Afghan government from the countryside and havens in neighboring Pakistan. The Bush and then Obama administrations added U.S. troops and turned to a new style of counterinsurgency warfare that relied on armed drone aircraft and special forces troops. U.S. diplomats helped guide the new war in the shadows. In 2011, Washington's attention shifted to a wave of popular uprisings in the Middle East that came to be called the Arab Spring. In February 2011, crowds of thousands in Cairo's streets forced the resignation of Hosni Mubarak, Egypt's ruler for the past 30 years. For the next 2 years, U.S. diplomats tried to steer the most populous Arab country toward a more democratic government. But in the summer of 2013, the military seized power from a democratically elected Islamist government and imposed the harshest rule the country has had in modern times. In 2011, the Obama administration was also drawn into a revolution in Libya, which had been ruled since 1969 by the erratic Muammar al-Qaddafi. U.S. forces joined a Western bombing campaign that protected the rebels from Qaddafi and enabled them by August to topple his government. But after the war ended and world powers turned their attention elsewhere, the country descended into bloody factional fighting and lawlessness that continues. The Obama administration sought to avoid a large military role in the civil war that broke out in Syria in the summer of 2011. As the war became the most devastating of the new century, a divided administration carried on a prolonged internal debate about military involvement. It chose to focus instead on unsuccessful attempts to negotiate a peace between President Bashar al-Assad and the rebel opposition. By the close of Obama's second term, the Assad government and its Iranian and Russian allies had gained the upper hand in the war. The Obama administration found getting out of wars was harder than getting into them. After withdrawing the last U.S. troops from Iraq in 2011, the administration was compelled to return some forces to the region in 2014 to halt the advance of a new insurgent group that was seizing land in Iraq and Syria. The so-called Islamic State, heir to the Sunni insurgents who ignited civil war after the Iraq invasion, controlled at its peak territory as large as Britain. U.S., Iraqi, and allied forces gradually reclaimed the land. President Donald Trump, who campaigned in 2016 on bringing an end to the Middle Eastern wars, was still wavering in the third year of his presidency on how quickly to withdraw the last U.S. forces from Syria and Afghanistan. The diplomats sent on the Middle Eastern missions were a small part of the more than 3 million Americans on the expeditions. The vast majority were military, but they also included intelligence officers, aid specialists, drug agents, and others. The biggest frontline embassies in Iraq, Pakistan, and Afghanistan were sprawling frontier forts with thousands in staff from more than 30 U.S. agencies. In 2008, when the U.S. Embassy in Baghdad was the largest in U.S. history, the country was host to 170,000 U.S. troops and 154,000 U.S. contractors, but had only 140 officers handling the core diplomatic work. Yet the top Foreign Service officers were mainsprings of these missions. In battle zones where most in the U.S. military knew nothing of the locals, the ambassadors understood language and custom and could lead Washington around the blind curves of local politics. They were confidants of local leaders, able to steer them through crisis.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.